I do want to say to all our brothers joining us online down in California, I want y'all to know we're praying for you. Keep those questions coming. I'm appreciating them. Thank you. But last week we were in Smyrna, and what we said was that this was one of the only churches with Philadelphia that were not receiving a critique. It was an exhortation. They were being persecuted. They were very poor. Jesus said, I know that you're utterly destitute, but you're rich. I know your persecution. And the word Smyrna, it means myrrh, which myrrh was used to anoint the dead. It was used to embalm the dead. It was used at crucifixions where the women would mix the myrrh with wine and provide that to those that were crucified. And that would sort of intensify the numbing effect to ease their passing. And so even in the name of Smyrna, there's this sort of connotation of death. And we talked about that this from the historicist view, this church represented the persecution period of the church, roughly 100 to 313 AD. And so going back to that, each church represents a period in chronological order, in sequence, a period in the church, a sort of theme. We looked at Ephesus, and Ephesus represented the apostolic age, and Smyrna represents the persecuted age of the church. And so today we're looking at what are we looking at? Pergamum. Sorry. But still, going back to Smyrna, we said that they were being persecuted. They were being persecuted because of their faith. And though that they were utterly poor in this world, they had riches in the kingdom of God. And that didn't make sense because how can you be rich and poor at the same time? And we said there's two realities that we live in. There's the reality of this world, and there's the reality of the kingdom of God. And these realities are opposed to one another. One is going to pass away, and one is eternal. And so we look to that eternal kingdom. Amen. We don't store up treasures here in this world. We look to the kingdom. And Paul, he puts this wonderfully. He says, therefore, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, 16 through 18, he says, therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and our momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And so we store our treasure up in heaven. Though we can't see it, we know that is eternal. Here, everything that we see, it is temporary. And so how do you see something how do you set your eyes on something that you don't see? If you look around you and you see something, don't set your eyes on that. Just keep looking until you don't see anything and set your eyes on that. Amen. And so, like I said, today we're in Pergamum, and Pergamum, it's a contracted word. It comes from the word per or peri, and that means to be thoroughly or wholly or sort of encompassing. And then you get Pergamos. Pergamos means to be given in marriage or to marry. And so you have this meaning of to be thoroughly married or to be wholly married, not holy, but wholly married. And this is the situation that Jesus is going to address with this church, because they were attempting to marry things that were incompatible. To be married, we know that when a man leaves his mother and his father, he cleaves to his wife. The two become married. The two become one. And so they were attempting to make one what cannot be. They were attempting to mix what is incompatible with the body of Christ. These two worlds, I said, these two realities, they are diametrically opposed to one another. They cannot mix. They cannot. And such is this age in the period of the church. We refer to this as the state church, where after Constantine, he made Christianity the state religion. The church began to mix things with the world, with the church. And so they look at this period as the period of the church being thoroughly married with the state church. And so this church, looking at the historicist view, this represents the state church. But we understand that we cannot mix what is incompatible. The reality of this world is incompatible with the kingdom of God. You cannot mix. It's like mixing oil and water. You can blend it, you can shake it together as much as you want, but the two, they're not going to mix together. That is the reality. You could try as you may, but it's not going to happen. But we struggle with that. We want to mix with what is of this world, with what is of God, and it cannot, it must not transpire. So it's written, to the angel of the church of Pergamum, write, there are words. These are the words of him who has the sharp double-edged sword. I've been saying this and I'll keep saying it. Pay attention to how Jesus is describing himself to the church. It gives an indication of the issue and what they're wanting, what Christ is wanting the church to know. He's saying, I am the one with the sharp double-edged sword coming out of my mouth. We understand that sharp double-edged sword to be the word of God. It pierces right to the very heart of things. It doesn't fiddle-faddle around. It gets right to the point. It cleaves to the very center of things. It speaks of judgment as well. One that has the ability to judge and determine what is right and what is wrong. And that is what we use the word for. We use the word when we're going through situations and we really don't know or understand how to go. We look to the word, because the word will tell us and give us direction, because against the word, everything either fails or it lines up. That is the measuring rod, the word of God. It is that apparatus to which we know what is right and what is true. Amen. And an example of this, when I one of my first jobs that I worked in construction. I was a tile setter. And we would, in Florida, everybody had pools there because it's so hot and humid. And so we would put tile around the pools. So you see the tile in the pools. And so there was all these kind of fancy gadgets and gadgets to get a level line in the pool so you can start to put the tile. I mean, thousands of dollars for some of these apparatuses. And so we used a very simple apparatus. We took just a clear tube, a long tube, and we filled that thing with water. And it cost about $5 to do this. And when you take one side on the other, and you take one side on the other side, and when the water was still, when it was level, that was your mark. You'd make your mark, and you'd go around, and you'd make your marks. And the point of that was that, so, you know, when you fill a pool up with water, and the water is still, if it's an eighth of an inch off, it's going to be noticeable. You will see it because the water is level, but the tile is not. So why not use what's going to determine if it's level or not? And so that's what we did. We used a water level. And so the same thing with the word of God. We use the word of God to determine what is right and what is wrong, what is straight and what is crooked. If it is not lining up, even the 1/8 of an inch, it will be off. It will be noticeable. And so we use the word of God to determine what is right and what is wrong. It is the measuring rod to which we determine righteousness. He says, we also know that this sword, a sword is used to divide. A sword divides, whether in whole or it separates. If you take a knife, a butcher's knife, a sharp butcher's knife, and you get a big chunk of meat on the table and you whack that thing, it's going to divide that big piece of meat. It's going to cut it in two. It separates. And the word of God, it separates that which is of the world with that which is of God. Does that make sense? As you adhere to the word, you begin to cleave to the kingdom of God. Does that make sense? It separates. It divides. It either you're going to line up with it or you're going to fall short of it. And that's what he's saying. I am the one with that sharp double-edged sword coming out of my mouth. Not them, not those, not the politicians, not those that are trying to get you to go astray. I am the one. Look to my word, because my word, it measures up. My word is the apparatus that is going to be used to judge and to condemn. And so this is what it means when we adhere and line up with the word of God. It begins to separate us. This is what it means to be holy or to go through this process of sanctification. We are set apart from this world and we are being sanctified. This is the work of the Holy Spirit and this is the work of the word of God. As we allow it to seep into the heart, we are transforming, conforming to the image of Christ. Set apart from this world, divided from this world. Though we are in this world, we are not of this world. Amen. And so Jesus is reminding them this. Listen, I am the one. You need to go back and look at my word. And so he says, I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. Now here, we have the commendation. Christ is, he's encouraging them. He's saying, you're doing this good. Though you're in this terrible place, you have not denied the faith. You've held true to my name. This Antipas, we really don't have a biblical account of who he is. Early Christian tradition would have it that he was the actual bishop of this church, and he refused to deny Christ. He refused to yield. And so for that, they said, tradition has it, that they placed him in this bronze bull or this idol of Baal. And they put him in this bronze bull and set him over a fire and roasted him alive. This was typical. This is what they would do. And from the nostrils, you could hear the moaning and groans and screams of the individual inside as they died. And so that's the earliest Christian tradition of who this Antipas is, but it's not conclusive. And so he talks about this throne of Satan. I don't think it's saying that Satan was actually there, that that's where his throne was, but there was so much paganism, as just as we've seen in all these other cities. There was so much paganism in this city. It was one of the first cities. I think it was the first city that was allowed to erect a statue unto Caesar, because they worshiped Caesar and they were so zealous in their worship of Caesar. They were the first to be granted the permission to erect this statue unto him. I think Smyrna, they came in second, maybe a couple of years after them. They were granted permission to erect this statue unto Caesar. And there was all sorts of pagan temples there. There was all sorts of deities that they worshiped. Zeus, they had this tremendous throne. It looked like an actual throne set up on this high mountain for Zeus. And so one coming into the city, looking up at this thing, it would seem as though there was a tremendous throne. And so that's, scholars think that's perhaps what this this reference to the throne of Satan could be. And speaking of, this is where Satan lives. Like I said, there's so much paganism going on there. There was this temple that they erected to, see if I can say this right, Aesculapius, this Greek god Aesculapius. And he was considered the god of medicine. And what they would do, it was sort of a sanatorium where they would go in and spend days in this, those that were sick. And they had all these non-venomous snakes in this temple. And it was believed that if the snake crawled over you, you'd be healed. And the sign or the rod, what is considered the rod of Aesculapius, we see even to this day. You see it in pharmacies, you see it on hospitals, the sign of this rod with this snake twirled around it. That is a Greek pagan, that's Greek paganism, this rod of Aesculapius. But he says, I know where you live. I know where you live. Despite all of this paganism, despite all of what's going on in this city, you've remained true. You've remained true, but look at what he says. I know where you live. This is peculiar. Typically, well, the word here for live is katoikeo. And typically, when we're referencing the saints and where we live here, we use the word parapateo. And there's a difference. It's a contrast here because katakeo, it means to take up a permanent abode, to take up permanent residence. You're not just passing by. The parapateo, it refers to one that is simply passing, sojourning, not going to take up a permanent seating there. And so it's interesting because this is the word we typically use when we're talking of saints, because we know that we are not of this world. We are simply passing through. We're not taking up permanent residence here. But he's saying that I know that you've taken up permanent residence here. And many will look at this and say, well, this is it's negative. They shouldn't be trying to live there, but this is a part of the commendation. So I see this as a positive. He's commending them. And this is the thing, because despite living in this heavily saturated pagan world, they've taken up a stand. They're saying that we're going to stand our ground. We're not simply going to be passing by. We're going to stay here and we're going to make a stand. What better place to shine our light than in this city of darkness? And so he's commending them. I know you've taken a stand in this filth. You've taken a stand in the mess. And I know that's something that we struggle with. The church today, we struggle with, because when we can, what we like to do, we like to go out in the middle of nowhere and we like to buy these large compounds. We buy acres upon acres and we build these fancy compounds when we have the money. And that's where we go and worship, because we don't want to be bothered by anyone else. We want to go out and be where we can be, and nobody can bother us, and we're not bothering anybody. If we want to shout praises to God, we can do that out where nobody else can see us. We do that. We do that corporately. We do it individually. I know that many of you know that there's somebody that moved out of here during this pandemic. I heard just people, they moved out of this area, King County, Pierce County, they moved west or east, to get out of the east, the west, and move to the east, because this is, they said, it's just too much. It's just too much to deal with. It's going too far to the other side. And so I want to go where, you know, people think like me. People, I can worship in peace. I can get away from all of that mess, this filth. And so people, they've moved away. And I'm not going to lie, that sounds very enticing. It does. I. This is a problem that I started to face when I started preaching. Because you come across things and you see applications to things. And you say, well, if I talk about that, then I'm being a hypocrite because I do the same thing. Because I do that. And so what I decided I'd do, well, I just have to own up to it. So I can't wag the finger at anybody until I wag the finger at myself, because I did this. I did this to an extent greater than most people. Because back in 2008, I had enough. I said, enough of this. I'm getting out of here. I'm leaving. And that's what I did. I left everything behind. I took just a carry-on bag with me, and I moved to Africa. And I said, I wasn't coming back. I told my family, y'all going to have to come see me because I'm not coming back. And my plan, what I wanted to do, my intent was to go out in the middle of nowhere and find some land in the middle of nowhere and live there by myself. And that's what I did. That's what I did. I erected this compound and I lived there. And my plan was to live like a monk, to work the land and just to have my time with God, to walk around by myself praising God. That's what I did. I got away from all that. All of this. And nobody in the world can tell me for a second that God didn't have a sense of humor. Because though I was out in the middle of nowhere, don't you know people just started showing up? People just started showing up. I had a big wall around this place, and I just heard knocks on the door, and I'm like, who in the world is this? And people just, hey, can we use your water? I had a well, and so people wanted to come in and draw water from the well. Sure, have at it. At night, I had solar panels, so I was the only one you could see for miles on end, the light. There was light there. And so people said, oh, well, what's this? And people started coming. And I was not by myself. I don't think I ever spent one day by myself because people were just drawn to that area. And if you look at it on a map today, this little place that I built in the middle of nowhere, it is sort of the epicenter of a small town. I kid you not. But this is what God has called us to do.
Higginsville?
He's called us to be the light. What sense does it make to take the light amongst the light and hide it somewhere out where no one else can see? We are called to be the light, to shine our light in darkness. Amen. And so this is what this church is doing. They've taken up a stand. And this is what we're called to do. And I tell you, I think about it often as I get so tired and angry and frustrated of what goes on in this neighborhood. You won't believe. I'll spare you the details. I was like, man, wouldn't it be good just to go out somewhere else where I wouldn't have to deal with this? But God has called us to be the light in darkness. Amen? So they've taken up this permanent residence here. It's written, nevertheless, I have a few things against you. There are some among you who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin, so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you also have those who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Now, if you remember this story with Balaam and Balak and the Moabites, they saw all the Israelites coming into the land, and they said, hey, this is a problem. They're going to lick up all the resources. So Balak, he hired Balaam, this sort of soothsayer, to go and curse the Israelites. And so every time Balaam went to open his mouth to curse them, he uttered a blessing on them. And Balak is sitting there. It's like, what are you doing? I paid you good money to curse these people. And he's like, I can only say what God puts in my mouth to say. And so later on, we find that Balaam was going to get his money. He's like, no, I'm going to figure this out. I'm going to get my money. And so what he did was he told, I know how you can bring a curse on these people. Take your women, take your beautiful women, and send them down there with these Israelites. And let them mingle, let them mix together, because then they will get them to worship their gods. I know this God of theirs. He's a jealous God. He's not going to tolerate that. Get them to go down there and start mixing with what is not of God. And this is what they did. This is what is referred to as the doctrine of Balaam, this way of enticing the people to commit idolatry. And we talked about the Nicolaitans. I cannot say that. It's believed, we don't know definitively who this is, but it's believed that this was one of the first of the deacons appointed in Acts. And early Christian tradition has it that he went astray. He apostatized into this antinomianism. There was this sort of thought of hyper grace, that we could sin with impunity and just be forgiven. And then there's the Gnostic view of what they brought to the church. And so Jesus is saying, you're mixing what is of the world with what is of God. And it cannot be. You tolerate this. You allow this to transpire, and you know better. Because you know these two worlds, the kingdom of God and this world, they are diametrically opposed. They cannot mix. They must not. You must not even try it. I know you tolerate this. Stop doing it. And the church, we still struggle with this. We struggle with this to this very day. Because we like to take what's of the world and mix it in with what is of God. Ideologies. Perspectives. politics. We mix it in with the church, and it does not belong. It mustn't take place in the body of Christ because they are diametrically opposed. Try as you may, but they will not mix. They will not mix. They cannot mix. We struggle with this. And I know we want to be, we live in a world that we're trying to minister to, and so we want to be compassionate. We want to be amicable. We want to have relationships with people. We want to be loving, and amen. But there is that truth, he says. I am the one with that double-edged sword coming out of my mouth. Upon that sword, upon that word, truth is established. Upon that word will determine what is right and what is wrong. Have your relationships, but you line up with my word. There's no compromising that word. We like to twist and turn and rearrange the word of God. But like I said, you take a double-edged sword and stick your hands on it and try to twist it and turn it and see what happens. It cannot be. It must not. Do not mix with what is of God and what is of this world. They are incompatible. You're fooling yourself. It cannot be. It cannot take place. You can try as you may, but it's not going to happen. He says, I am the one with the word coming out of my mouth. I mean, if you were, this is the word, by this word we are saved. By the word of God we are saved. If you were drowning in the ocean and you come across a life preserver and you find your salvation in this life preserver, and then you see someone else drowning, what sense does it make to leave the life preserver behind to go and to try to help this person and then both of you drown? Take the life preserver with you and share it with them. Take this word and share it. Don't leave it behind. Don't manipulate it. Don't twist it. Don't turn it. Leave it as it is. Stand on this word. It is a double-edged sword. You can't do it. You can try if you may, but you're going to get cut. He says, repent, therefore. Otherwise, I will soon come to you and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Notice he says, I will fight against them. I know somebody may say, well, better them than me. But understand this, what he's saying. In Ezekiel chapter 3, it says, when I say to a wicked person, you will surely die, and you do not warn them or speak out to dissuade them from their evil ways in order to save their life, that wicked person will die for their sin, and I will hold you accountable for their blood. We are held accountable for those that we do not share this truth for. When you see your brothers and sisters going a separate way, you don't got to beat them over the head. We like to do that. We like to take the word of God and beat one another over the head and say, no, you're wrong. This is what this says. And we quote all the passages, but we don't do it in love. We don't do it in a way that says, no, I love you. I see you walking astray, and this is what the word says. Brother, sister, come back and stand on this word. We can do it together. This word is true. We are accountable for our brothers and sisters. Are you your brother's sister, your brother and your sister's keeper? Are you? We are accountable. He says, whoever has an ear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give some of the hidden manna. I will also give that person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who received it. This white stone, it has many implications. It was used in this time to in jurors, when they had a judicial proceeding, jurors would cast their vote with a white stone to say that they were innocent. If you were guilty, they'd cast a black stone. It was a token of admittance to a wedding feast. It was given to the victors of these Olympic games. And so there's several connotations to that. Perhaps we can look at them all and say they're all applicable. But this hidden manna as well. This is the manna that God provided for Israel as they were wandering in the desert. But look at what he says in John, the Gospel of John, what Jesus said in chapter 6, verses 47 through 51. He says, very truly I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which anyone may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Amen. Christ is that bread of life, that living bread that we partook in today. It is the bread of life. I will give of you that hidden manna. Whoever has an ear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This is for all of us to hear, to accept, and to stand on. Stand your ground. Don't get afraid because the mess, because it's a bunch of foolishness. The world around you, what Satan is doing, stand your ground. Christ will sustain you. But shine your light. Shine your light in this mess. And don't mix what is of God with what is of the world. The two must remain separate. Amen? Amen. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for this reminder to just stand our ground, to stand on your word, to keep as we are being sanctified, we are being set apart for your will and your ways, to stand in that, to live in that, to not try and mingle and mix with what you've saved us from. Just thank you for that reminder. I pray these words fall not upon deaf ears, but it seep into our hearts, that we will receive it and stand on it. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We give you all the glory, all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.